Good afternoon, and just remind members, as always, that social distancing rules are in place throughout the Parliament and the Chamber. I know that members are very careful observing them. Before we turn to First Minister's questions, I believe the First Minister will give us a brief statement updating us on the latest figures in the government's response to coronavirus. First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will start with a brief statistical update on COVID-19. As at 9 o'clock this morning, there have been 13,929 positive cases confirmed, an increase of 166 from yesterday. A total of 1,534 patients are in hospital with confirmed or suspected cases of the virus. That is a decrease of 84 from yesterday. A total of 70 people last night were in intensive care with confirmed or suspected COVID-19. That is a decrease of 11 since yesterday. But in the last 24 hours, I'm afraid that 61 deaths have been registered of patients who had been confirmed as having the virus. That takes the total number of deaths in Scotland under that daily measurement to 1,973. However, National Records of Scotland has just published its latest and more detailed weekly report. Unlike the daily figures, it includes those with a confirmed laboratory diagnosis of COVID-19 and also cases where the virus is entered on the death certificate as a suspected cause of death or as a contributory factor in a death, but where no formal test had been carried out. The latest publication covers the period up to Sunday, 10th of May, which is 3 days ago. At that point, according to our daily figures, 1,862 deaths had been registered of people who had tested positive for the virus. However, today's report shows that by Sunday, the total number of registered deaths linked to the virus, confirmed and presumed, was 3,213. 415 of those deaths were registered in the 7 days up to Sunday. I can report that this is a decrease of 110 from the week before and a decrease of 244 from 2 weeks previously. Deaths in care homes made up 57% of all deaths linked to the virus last week. That is a slightly lower proportion than the previous week. And also the total number of COVID deaths in care homes, while still too high, fell to 238 from 314 the week before. Finally, the total number of deaths recorded from all causes last week was again higher than the five-year average, but lower than in the week before. This figure, the number of what we sometimes refer to as excess deaths, fell from 600 to 400. Now, I readily acknowledge that no trend in statistics can ever comfort the many people who have lost a loved one to this virus, and my thoughts and sympathies are with each and every one of them. But this week's figures do offer further and perhaps sustained signs of hope. The number of COVID-related deaths, although far too high, has fallen for a second week in a row. The number of deaths in care homes has also reduced for a second week, and the number of excess deaths is less than half the level it was at 3 weeks ago. That doesn't mean we can relax yet. There are still too many cases. The reproduction rate of the virus is still higher than we would like, and we continue to learn more about those most vulnerable to the disease. The NRS report today gives further analysis of deaths by deprivation, age, urban-rural classification, and other health conditions. And Health Protection Scotland has also just published its second report breaking down all cases by characteristics such as age, sex, and deprivation. But the trends we are seeing now are positive. If transmission rates continue to fall, we will be able to gradually relax the lockdown restrictions. But we will continue to err on the side of caution. And so for the moment, as I confirmed on Sunday, the message in Scotland remains the same. Please stay at home except for essential purposes. That is essential work, exercise, or shopping for food and medicine. When you do leave home, stay more than 2 metres from other people and don't meet up with people from households other than your own. Wear a face covering if you're in a shop or on public transport and wash your hands thoroughly and regularly. Finally, if you or someone else in your household has symptoms of the virus, then you should stay at home completely. Sticking with this, as today's figures show, is making a difference. We are slowing the spread of this virus. We are protecting our NHS and we are saving lives. We're also bringing forward the time that these restrictions can start to be eased. So my thanks go once again to everyone across the country who is doing exactly that.
Thank you very much, First Minister. Now, before we turn to our first question, just a few points about the nature of First Minister's questions today. It is returning to its normal format in the sense that there are three questions from backbenchers at questions 5, 6, and 7. That means that I will take all supplementary questions after question 7 today, including potential supplementaries on questions 5 or 6. So all supplementaries will be after question 7. There's also the option for members to join us remotely. So any member who is not currently in the chamber who wishes to dial in is able to do so and join us and ask a question through our screens here. And finally, I know that the First Minister has offered and last week was willing to take every single question that is put to her. However, we do have business scheduled for this afternoon, including a bill. So I intend to allow up to an hour, and I don't want to, there'll be some flexibility, but I don't intend to run much over that, but up to an hour for all questions, and hope we get the balance right between questions from the leaders and opportunities for all other members to ask questions. So hope we can follow all of that. And on that note, we turn to our first question from Jackson Carlow.
Presiding Officer, on Channel 4 last night, in a harrowing report, we heard from carers at the Highgate care home in Uddingston. 22 residents have tragically died since the start of this outbreak, one a day at its peak. And yet these carers said that still the majority of them had not been tested. First Minister, that's an outrage, isn't it?
First Minister.
Testing in care homes has been driven by clinical advice. In recent weeks, of course, we have increased testing in care homes. So care homes where there is an outbreak, we now have testing of all residents and all staff, whether or not they are symptomatic of the virus. And those efforts, both in testing and in infection prevention and control, are driven by the leadership of public health directors in each health board area. We now have enhanced surveillance in care homes where there is a virus and surveillance across all care homes. Where there are individual concerns raised about individual care homes, we will look into those very carefully and discuss with public health directors, with local health protection teams, and of course with the care inspectorate, whether there are issues that require to be addressed, and where there are, we will address those issues urgently. The situation in care homes, not just in Scotland but UK-wide and indeed globally, has been one of the most distressing factors of a very distressing situation overall. At every step, whether it is infection prevention and control, whether it is testing, whether it is the support through PPE provision that we are giving to care home providers, we have and will continue to take steps to protect older people in our care homes. The most distressing thing about this, of course, is that we know, as some of the statistics that will be published today bear out, that this is a virus that still has no vaccine and no treatment that is hitting older people particularly hard. And that makes the obligation on all of us to protect older people as well as we possibly can all the greater. And that is what the government will continue to do.
Jackson Carlow.
First Minister, all our thoughts go out to those affected, the families, and indeed those who care deeply for the residents in their charge, feel a deep responsibility. But what they want to hear is that promises from politicians have been kept. And the issue here is very simple. On the 1st of May, the First Minister promised that our government would undertake at care homes reporting cases of COVID-19, advanced outbreak investigation, involving all residents and staff, regardless of symptoms. In other words, everyone would be tested. Yet speaking last night, one carer at the home, Andy Sturgeon, said he had still not been tested, and he fears that he and his colleagues may be bringing the disease into the home. He said, as soon as it was a confirmed case, I think we should all have been tested. First Minister, why wasn't he?
First Minister.
The advanced outbreak investigation, which is what I referred to in my opening answer, is the policy that is and should be being pursued in each care home where there is an outbreak. That is the approach that has been led by public health directors and by local health protection teams, obviously in partnership with care home providers. Where there are, and I've said this all along, and I've said it with every single aspect of tackling this virus, whether it is testing, whether it is the provision of PPE, where we get reported to us any instance where on the face of it, it appears that what should be happening in policy terms is not happening in practice, we will investigate that. We will do that with the issues that Jackson Carlow is raising, and we will continue to make sure that the approaches we are saying should be taken will be taken. We have all along been determined to make sure that older people in care homes are protected, and protected in the way that their families and loved ones would expect. I cannot stand here and say other than this is a virus that globally is hitting older people particularly hard, and a virus that we know is spreading particularly in institutional settings. We are also, I think, much more than in perhaps other parts of the UK, making sure that all of that is reported fully in the figures that I report on the numbers of people dying each and every single day. So we will continue. Unfortunately, while we're seeing positive signs, even in care homes, although the situation there remains of huge concern, although we are seeing positive signs in the case numbers, that those in hospital and those dying from this virus, we are not through this pandemic yet. And I, the Health Secretary and the government will continue to focus completely on doing everything that needs to be done to make sure people get the response that they have a right to expect.
Jackson Carlin.
But presiding officer, advanced outbreak investigation did not happen in Uddingston. Is that also true elsewhere? We know this. We know that Scotland is lagging far behind other parts of the UK in making good use of total testing capacity. It's also reported today that the ratio of care home deaths in Scotland is double that of the figure elsewhere across the UK. Fewer tests for our care homes, more deaths in our care homes. First Minister, who is taking responsibility for this?
First Minister.
I take responsibility for all aspects of the government's response to this. Well, people can and should, and it's perfectly legitimate, scrutinise and where necessary, criticise. I don't think even my externest critic could say I've not been standing up day in and day out taking responsibility for this government's handling of this virus epidemic. Can I just say, on the point of the rate of deaths in care homes in Scotland compared to other parts of the UK, fairness to Jackson Carlow, it's a study that I've only just seen this morning, but there has been a study published this morning by academics at the London School of Economics that suggests that in England and Wales, the real care home death toll is double what the official figures is showing. Now, this is not some kind of competition. Any death toll in care homes or anywhere else is too high, and all of us are working to get that down. But I am confident that the figures we are publishing in Scotland are accurate. I'm not sure that's the case for elsewhere in the UK right now, but it is not for me to speak to those figures. I also know, and this is tragic as well, that the percentages of overall deaths that are happening in care homes in Scotland look to be, unfortunately, in line with many other countries that are reporting these figures. That comes back to two points for me. Firstly, that this is a virus that is hitting older people, particularly how the vast majority of deaths are in the older population, and that's not just in care homes, that is overall. And secondly, that managing and tackling this virus in care homes is the biggest part of the responsibility, the big responsibility that government, health protection teams, care home providers, all of us bear in tackling this. And every single day that we are dealing with this virus, it will be my absolute focus to make sure we are doing everything possible to do that.
Jackson Carlin.
Presiding officer, fixing testing must become this government's overriding focus, and it's clear it hasn't been. It's also clear that the government could have been more transparent about what it was doing for care homes in the early days of the outbreak. Mistakes were made at the start, and they have led to the excess deaths we see today. First Minister, in light of the tragedy in Uddingston and others, do you agree that when it comes to testing and care homes, that by any standards, this is a failure?
First Minister.
No, I don't. Let me say, I'm not even speaking as First Minister here, I'm speaking as a human being. I deeply regret every single death from this virus, and I think all of us are in that position. But I also know, and I said, I think the very first time I stood in this chamber and talked about what we were dealing with, I said that mistakes would be made. I said I would make mistakes, the government would make mistakes. We are dealing with an unprecedented situation, and I am sure that is the case. There is not a day, there's probably not an hour goes by right now where I don't question myself, I don't agonise over the decisions we are taking, to make sure that we are learning as we go and we are getting these decisions as right as possible. And I suspect everybody, I hope everybody in a leadership position the world over right now is going through that same process. And I will continue to do that. On testing, we have dramatically increased our testing capacity. We are increasing the number of tests being done. But I think it's really important to understand, right now we're in a phase where testing is clinically driven. These tests, particularly for older people, are not pleasant. They are invasive tests, and therefore there does need to be a degree of clinical judgment about when a test is appropriate and when it's not. So the categories that are being tested right now are clinically driven. We are also in a process, as many countries are, of moving into test, trace, isolate, where your approach to testing is different. So the capacity that we are building just now is to prepare for that. And the approach to testing then becomes completely different. So all of these aspects are absolutely... Jackson Carlow talked about my overriding focus. All of these aspects are my focus right now. But let me tell you what my overriding focus is. My overriding focus is to protect the population of this country as best I can against what we know is a potentially deadly virus, and to err on the side of caution, to take decisions in a very careful and considered way to make sure that we are reducing as far as possible the numbers who die from this virus, and certainly those who die unnecessarily. That is my focus every waking moment right now, and it will absolutely continue to be so.
Thank you. Question two, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all want to see the government succeed in this fight against this virus. Defeating COVID-19 and saving lives is our top priority, which is why, again, we must raise the issue of care homes, because that is what people have asked us to do. The latest figures produced yesterday by independent professional statisticians did show that the proportion of deaths from COVID-19 in Scottish care homes is nearly double that in England. And last week, the former chief medical officer to the Scottish Government, Sir Harry Burns, said in his evidence to this Parliament's COVID-19 committee, and I quote him, "If one of the elderly residents is exposed to the virus, they are much more likely to get it. The nurses might then spread it unwittingly." That is clearly what is happening. Does the First Minister agree with Sir Harry Burns that this is what is happening?
First Minister.
We know this virus is spreading more aggressively in care homes, partly because of the nature of the population in care homes, but also because it is an institutional setting where people are together. And there are other institutional settings where that is a risk as well, hospitals being the other obvious example. That is why we do take a different approach to managing the outbreak in care homes than we do more generally around testing, but around the infection control procedures that have been in place since the early stages of this epidemic. We will continue to learn as we go to make sure that we are adapting that as the evidence tells us how we best tackle that. The death toll in care homes, not just in Scotland, but globally, is an absolute tragedy. And, you know, there is not a day, it's not a minute goes by that I don't reflect on that. But this is a virus that we know is particularly harmful to older people, and that's why we've got to make sure that these approaches are properly tailored to that. Can I, as I did to Jackson Carlow, I just want to, and I'll say this again, I'm really not interested, I've not been interested since the start of this in political comparisons or anything. It is just not relevant to me right now. But I do want to challenge this, that the death toll in care homes is double what in Scotland, what elsewhere in the UK. I do not believe that is the case. And I would point again to the study that has been published this morning that actually suggests that the disparity is down to under-reporting in the rest of the UK, and that Scotland's figures, which I think are more in line with the international examples, are accurate, whereas, according to this study, the numbers dying in care homes in England and Wales is double what the official figures is showing. So I would really just caution people against the conclusion that twice now in the chamber has been articulated, because I really don't believe that is true. I think if there is a disparity here, it comes from a problem in reporting elsewhere, not from the reality of the position here in Scotland. But as I say, whether it's one death or many hundreds of deaths, it is too many. And my focus is on making sure we work with clinical experts, health protection experts, with care home providers who, you know, I say have a big responsibility here as well, that we all work together to make sure we are reducing the toll that this virus is taking on care homes in particular, but on our older population in general. And the numbers today, while they are still far too high, are for the second week declining. which suggests that we are starting to see, although we have a long way to go, a tailing off of the impact of this virus in care homes, as hopefully we're seeing in the wider community as well.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you, and thank you for that answer. Irrespective of the international comparisons, we've just been told that 57% of all COVID-19 related deaths in Scotland were in Scotland's residential care homes for the elderly. So let me also turn to that moving Channel 4 interview broadcast last night with care worker Andy Sturgeon, because he also said this. He said, "I can't see how a virus like this can go from one end of the care home to the other end when both of these people are in their bed. The only reason I can think of is that it is us. We are the carriers." This is exactly the point that Sir Harry Burns was making in his evidence to this Parliament last week. And let me remind the First Minister, that care home in Uddingston, Highgate, was the first to experience a COVID-19 outbreak where tragically 22 residents died. First Minister, every day and every night, care home staff are going to work in fear. A fear that they are passing on the virus to their residents, people who they care for deeply. The anxiety and guilt that they feel is a burden which they should not have to carry. Now more than ever, they need our support. So will the First Minister give a guarantee to every care home worker in Scotland, a guarantee of the right to be tested, and make that right a reality by taking testing stations to the workers rather than the workers having to go to testing stations?
First Minister.
The last point is a very fair point, and it's one that I think it's also important to clarify. We have a number of routes that people can get tested through right now, but care home workers like NHS staff who require to be tested should be tested through their NHS board. They can go onto the online portal and book a test at one of the drive-through centres or the mobile testing units, and that will refer them to wherever is closest, but that may not be very close to them. But they don't have to do that. That should be provided through their health board, and that should be done, obviously, locally to them. But that is, I think, a fair point to raise. In terms of access to testing, approach to testing in care homes has been set out in terms of access to staff who are symptomatic, to those who are not symptomatic, where there are outbreaks, and we will continue to work through local health protection teams with the leadership of public health directors to make sure that policy is being implemented in practice. Can I just put on record my overwhelming gratitude to those in the care home sector? I understand the anxiety they feel. They should not feel guilt about any aspect of this at all. They are doing an extraordinary job in the most horrendously difficult circumstances, and all of us owe them a huge debt of gratitude, and we will continue day in and day out to do everything we can to support them in what they are facing. My final point, just about the international comparisons, I don't really care. I care about what's happening here. The only reason I refer to these is because I think there is an issue here that we have to understand. All countries dealing with COVID-19 are dealing with this issue in care homes, and it's partly down to the nature of the virus. It doesn't take away our responsibility to deal with that, but the percentage of the 57% that Richard Leonard referred to from today's figures, which is a slight decline on last week, but it's still far too high. That figure, from the evidence I've seen from other countries, is broadly in line with other countries. Now, that doesn't say we shouldn't be extremely concerned about this. It tells us that there is a particular issue here that is not unique to Scotland. It is not somehow a problem caused because in Scotland we are not handling this virus in care homes in a way that other countries are. This is an intrinsic part of the really difficult nature of this virus, and that is what means we must continue to adapt. As we learn more about this virus, we adapt our responses accordingly, and we will continue to do that.
Richard Leonard.
Well, can I share another experience from Scotland today? Yesterday I was contacted by Anne. She is concerned about her granddaughter who works in a care home. The care home has a high staff sickness rate, and Anne told me that the manager is working extremely hard to cover shifts. The staff there are very worried. Some have broken down in tears, deeply distressed about the uncertainty of the situation. The residents have all been tested for COVID-19, but the staff have not. First Minister, this suggests to me that we have simply not learned all the lessons from the Highgate care home tragedy over 8 weeks ago. Anne told me that it shouldn't be up to staff, as she put it, if they feel they need it, to go to Glasgow Airport for testing. Testing should be readily available for everyone at the care home as required. Anne mentioned that in New York, under new rules just introduced, care home workers must be tested for coronavirus twice a week, and she thinks that we should do the same in Scotland. So given that so much testing capacity in Scotland is still going unused, will the First Minister commit today to consider that approach? And will she finally implement routine, regular, and repeat testing of care home workers as a critical part of the strategy for protecting residents and staff, and so saving lives?
First Minister.
We will continue to expand our approach to testing now based on clinical advice about how testing, as one tool that we have, because it is not the only tool, and I've said before, while testing is really important, if particularly in care homes, we focus entirely on testing at the expense of basic infection prevention and control, then that would be a mistake. But we will continue to expand our testing in this phase as we work towards the return to test, trace, isolate in a way that is clinically driven. Can I repeat what I said before about access to testing for care home workers? No care home worker who needs tested has to go through Glasgow Airport. That is an option for them if they book through the online portal. But care home workers, like NHS workers, have access to testing through their local health boards, and a care home provider who has an outbreak or who has care home staff that they think require testing should be requesting that testing from their local health board. And I think it's really important that people hear that message. It is not a requirement for health and social care workers to go through the drive-through system, even although if they want to and it suits their purposes, they are allowed to do that. More generally, in terms of care, Richard Leonard mentioned sickness absence levels in care homes. That is because as we test more care home workers, rightly, it will potentially lead to more care home workers being off work. And if they have the virus, they should be off work, obviously. But that's why we have a pool of staff that have come from the returners, the students who've stepped up to do clinical practice, NHS workers that can be deployed in care homes to make sure that if there are staffing issues, those can be dealt with, and also to reduce take away the risk that comes from staff moving from care home to care home. So that is a resource there for care home providers as well, and one that we encourage care home providers to make full and appropriate use of.
Thank you very much. Question number three, Alison Johnson.
Thank you. The Scottish Greens have long been calling for regular testing of frontline NHS staff and carers, and I very much welcome the growing recognition of the importance of it and the focus that we've had on that issue today. Research published this week showed that blanket testing of workers in a hospital in Cambridge found a significant number had the virus without even knowing it, despite appropriate PPE being used. This suggests that UK-wide 15,000 workers may have been on duty and infected. It's beyond doubt now that regular testing is needed both to protect frontline staff and to get control of the virus. A growing list of experts, as well as organisations including the Royal College of Nursing and the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, are asking for this to happen. The First Minister has reiterated today that the government will do everything possible to save lives and that she will err on the side of caution. So does the First Minister agree that regular testing for frontline NHS staff and carers should be introduced now?
First Minister.
If that is clinical advice that is given to me, we will accept that clinical advice. We have been increasing the categories of people tested, including categories of those working in our health and care system. We are also looking at and doing or starting to do what's called point prevalence testing in hospitals, which would give is a surveillance approach to see whether the virus is in hospital. So in all of these different aspects, we are expanding our capacity to test, and we are expanding the categories of people who are being tested. And I would remind people, and I'm the last person you will ever hear any complacency from in terms of the progress we're making in this virus, because as I keep saying, I think it is still fragile, but we are seeing now signs that this virus is, the impact of it is reducing. We are seeing that in care homes, although we have a long way to go, but we are seeing it more generally in case numbers, hospital admissions, ICU admissions, and the numbers of people who are dying. So that approach to testing is part of the progress that has been made, although overwhelmingly the progress has been made by people complying with the lockdown restrictions. As we start to lift these lockdown restrictions, then the approach to testing in order to keep control of outbreaks as and when they arise becomes more important and becomes a different focus. And I think Alison Johnston is right there in terms of that approach. Some of the approaches she's talking about are absolutely part of the consideration about that form of testing and that approach to, once we've suppressed the virus, to keep it suppressed, not just in the community, but in the institutions where we know it spreads most aggressively.
Alison Johnston.
Thank you. Regular testing is needed to protect frontline workers, but clearly we need to be taking action to protect everyone. COVID is a virus that attacks people's lungs, so the very last thing we should be doing just now are dropping public health measures that protect people's lungs. Dirty air in Scotland was killing thousands of people before the pandemic, and there's now strong evidence that it results in more people who catch COVID dying. Low emission zones are the Scottish Government's flagship policy to tackle air pollution. They were about to be rolled out, and suddenly they've been put on hold. So will the First Minister reverse this dangerous decision to ditch an important public health intervention in the midst of this public health emergency?
First Minister.
Look, I want to see low emission zones rolled out as quickly as possible in our cities and then over time beyond that. But we have a practical consideration right now, and we're far from alone in having that. The work required to introduce these things right now simply can't be done in the way it needs to be done, because we're telling people generally to stay at home. We are seeing, not just in central government, but in our councils and our health protection teams, people rightly having to focus on the immediate and urgent priority of tackling this virus. It is a matter of regret and irritation to all of us, and it's true across a whole range of work, that other strands of work are being impacted because of that. As we get it to a point closer to restoring some kind of normality to our lives, then we bring these work strands back into progress, and low emission zones will certainly be a priority for us as we do that. But unfortunately, with the best will in the world, we cannot escape the impact of dealing with this virus on a range of other practical pieces of work that have been underway, and the low emissions zone initiative falls into that category. But on the general point, I agree with Alison Johnston. If anything, what we're dealing with right now, it makes it more important that we continue the progress towards a net zero economy and society, but also take initiatives that make our air and our environments cleaner and healthier. If there's one thing that I think all of us have been very brutally reminded of in these past couple of months, is how important health is to all of us. And right now, that is a focus very much around this virus, but it has got more general and more fundamental lessons for us as we start to come out of this immediate response phase into thinking about what kind of society we want to build in the months and years to come.
Question four, Willie Rennie.
We have benefited from a UK-wide unity behind the message so far, but I've always been prepared to support doing things differently in Scotland if need be. However, I am nervous about England and Scotland diverging from each other because it may compromise the clarity that has so far saved lives. To justify a significantly different message, the scientific consensus needs to be significantly different too. So to settle my nerves and provide us all with the reassurance that I think we need, will the First Minister get her advisers to set out the details of the scientific difference between Scotland and England?
First Minister.
Let me come on to that point generally, and I hope I can offer something that is helpful in this regard. But can I say, first of all, and again, I don't say this in any pejorative or judgmental way. It's simply a statement of fact. Of the four UK nations, three of us, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, have decided to stick with the current stay-at-home message. England has decided to move a bit quicker out of lockdown. And that is entirely legitimate. They are absolutely entitled to do that. I am not criticising that. But to somehow, and I'm not suggesting Willie Rennie did this, but I've heard others suggest that Scotland has somehow broken away from a four nations approach is just not the case. And I think it's really important to be clear on that. Now, in terms of the data that drives this, you know, we publish data on a daily basis on case numbers, hospital admissions, ICU admissions, death numbers. We have published in the documents that we have put into the public domain in recent weeks, we've shown the trends in all of that. That data is then used to estimate what is called the R number, the reproduction rate. We use modelling output from a number of academic sources to validate the estimates we are making for the R number. And like the UK government does for England, we give that number in a range because the advice is it's because of the confidence intervals, it's more reliable to do it in that way, although I'm as anxious as anybody to get to more definition of that. The helpful thing I could offer, if people are interested, if opposition members want, I will arrange a technical briefing from the government statisticians to explain in a bit more depth how the R number is calculated. And I think that, because it is a very technical exercise, but it's basically done the same way in all countries. We don't make up how we do it here differently. But the fundamental point here, I guess, is this one, because you can look at all that data, and I'm happy for opposition members to look at that data just as I do. But ultimately, you, as a leader, you still have to apply your judgment to it, and you have to make decisions, because that's what people have elected me to do. And these judgments weigh very heavily right now. But the science will inform those judgments. They can't make the decisions for you. And my judgment right now is that the data is saying to me that the progress we've made is real, but it is still too fragile. And the risk, if we lift restrictions too soon, is that the virus could run quickly out of control again. So I am choosing, I am making the judgment, and I will stand accountable for it, that it is better now to err on the side of caution. Because if I get that judgment wrong, because these things are not certain, I would rather the price of getting that wrong is that people stay in lockdown for a few more days and that the price is not measured in unnecessary deaths. So that's the judgment I'm making. And I think it's the right one. But anybody is entitled to say that a different judgment, coming out of lockdown quicker, you know, getting people back to work quicker, is what we should be doing, and we can have that debate. But ultimately, political leadership, particularly at a time of crisis, is about exercising your judgment and making the decisions that are designed to keep people as safe as possible, and that's what I'm going to continue to do.
Willie Rennie.
That is a helpful response, and I think seeing some of that data and getting access to the scientists and their judgment about whether it is significantly different, I think will help inform the debate. And if the Prime Minister was here, I would ask him exactly the same question, because he's got to be held to account for the judgments that he's taking too about that divergence. Part of the difficulty is that there's a lack of testing in Scotland, so the confidence in that R number, I think, has to be less. And the margin of error, as ministers have quite rightly highlighted, is still quite significant. So to have the confidence in it, we need to be able to see the data and hear the analysis as well. The First Minister wants people to continue to stay at home. I will support her in amplifying that message. But we also need to know what is next. I assume that we will have to ease the lockdown before we have a vaccine or a cure. The calculation of how much and when and at what level of risk will need to be made by the First Minister and her ministers. So when will the government set out that plan with the level of detail that's been set out by governments across the globe? When will the testing and tracing capacity be ready for that? What will the new slogan be? What will follow stay at home?
There's a lot in there, but I'll be as brief as I can be. So on the R number, I am anxious that we get to a position where we can publish estimates of their number more regularly and narrow that range as much as possible. And, you know, as time goes on, we will be able to do that. The R number is really important, but the R number will be influenced also by the numbers of people who have immunity in the population. And also, having an R number close to one is always going to be a worry, but it is less of a worry if your incidence is lower, if the number of new cases you're having every day is lower, because then the higher R number is not going to increase them as quickly. If your incidence is higher, then that R number closer to one is a bigger worry. And our judgment right now is that both in terms of case numbers, but also the R number, is where the risk of moving too quickly is right now. But that is a judgment that moves and develops on a daily basis. In terms of setting out the plan, so Willie Rennie is right. We can't stay as we are forever, although, as I've said repeatedly, getting back to complete normality is probably not going to be possible until there's a vaccine or treatment. So we'll be living with aspects of this for a significant time to come. But we start to have to ease things to get a semblance of normality back. I would hope over the course of next week to set out what we think the phasing of that will be. But I will say very openly at that point that all of that will be subject to a degree of uncertainty, because we have to continue to look very carefully. If you look at other countries right now, your Germany has seen an increase in its R numbers. It starts to ease things. There are obviously new outbreaks in South Korea right now. There's new cases for the first time in quite a while being seen in Wuhan. So we have to monitor this very carefully. We will set out the potential phasing of that as soon as we are able to do that and try to get as much normality back as possible. One thing I'd say, Presiding Officer, there's a focus understandably on the economy and getting people back to work, and I'm as anxious to do that as anybody is for obvious reasons. But we have to also think about the social and family aspects of this. And what I'm really conscious of is if we try to, you know, put all of our focus on getting people back to work, but say every other aspect of their life has to stay in lockdown, we're actually, for people's quality of life, we're making decisions there that are really, really difficult. So I'm as anxious about the economy, but I also want to think about how we start to get some quality of family and community life back for people as well. My last point, Presiding Officer, because I know you're probably getting irritated at the length of this answer, is that TTI is a key part of this. But TTI, our capacity there, which we're building up and rapidly building up, will always have to be able to be flexed, because your need for that capacity will depend a lot on what your incidence and prevalence of the infection is. So if we suddenly have lots of outbreaks, you need more TTI capacity than you will if it's lower. So I would caution people against, of course, scrutinise a lot what we're doing around testing and contact tracing capacity, but I would caution against this idea that you get to X date and you just have the capacity that you will need on a fixed basis. We're always going to have to be prepared to flex that as we go. My apologies for the length of the answer, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, First Minister. Question number five, Jen Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether she will provide an update on how the Scottish Government is ensuring the security of supply of PPE for all frontline workers responding to the COVID-19 outbreak.
First Minister.
The Scottish Government is working with a range of partners within Scotland, across the UK and globally to ensure continued supply and distribution of PPE to essential frontline workforces. Since the 1st of March, over 125 million PPE items have been delivered to hospitals across Scotland, over 38 million to social care organisations and 9 million to community care. We have also been building a manufactured in Scotland PPI supply chain to provide security of supply for the future, overseen by Ivan McKee, and we're constantly looking to improve operations, and the changes made to distribution routes for PPE in health and social care are enabling supplies to be delivered where needed. We're working with health boards and NHS National Services Scotland to monitor PPE usage on an ongoing basis and plan future stock replenishment on the basis of that.
Julian Martin.
Thank the First Minister for that answer, and it's the new manufacturing in Scotland that I want to get some detail on. I'd like to know what plans there are to manufacture more of the PPE we need that currently has to be imported from elsewhere in the world, and what's been done to assist companies adapting their processes to this type of manufacturing to ensure that they meet the highest standards.
First Minister.
We've been working and will continue to work with a range of Scottish businesses to boost production of PPE to address critical shortages, but also more fundamentally to build future resilience and ensure that the highest quality standards are maintained. Scottish businesses are, of course, benefiting from a pipeline of NHS orders and also investment in capacity. For example, PPE manufacturers Alpha Solway, based in Annan, are currently producing 20,000 face visors every day for NHS Scotland as part of an order of 1.1 million visors. Scottish Enterprise has provided a £3.6 million loan repayable grant, rather, to Forfar-based textiles company Dawn and Lowe to allow them to invest in machinery to produce material which are used in high-grade face masks. And Berry BPI, with factories in Greenock and Dumfries, have invested in new machinery so that they can produce aprons and apron-style gowns for the NHS. So this is important now to make sure we've got that pipeline of supply, but what we are doing through this work is ensuring greater domestic resilience for these kind of essential items in the future. And I would take the opportunity to thank Ivan McKee and the team he's been working with for the very good work they've been doing to secure all of this.
Thank you. Question number five. Question number six, sorry. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that the NHS remains open for treating conditions other than COVID-19.
First Minister.
We've been very clear throughout this epidemic that the NHS is still there for those that need it, and it is very important that people seek help through their GP practice just as they would have done before. We launched the NHS is Open campaign on the 24th of April and urged people to contact their GP or their local hospital if they have urgent health worries. Since then, we have seen attendance numbers rise each week. In addition, the latest data shows that there has been an increase in the number of urgent suspected cancer referrals. We're also beginning to consider how NHS boards will restart services, including screening and elective procedures. That will be done on a phased basis. Over the coming weeks, we'll be developing a clinical priorities framework that will help to inform how the health and care system is aligned and managed during the next phase of the COVID-19 response and beyond.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the First Minister for that response? And I do recognise the messaging that's gone out saying the NHS is open for business. However, I think on the ground there's some different things coming through here. We already know there's a 70% reduction in cancer referrals, which will inevitably have an effect long past COVID-19. And there are continuing reports of clinics cancelled, an example of which at CPG for chronic pain, which my colleague Miles Briggs convened last Monday, where we heard harrowing stories of patients having to take a 10-hour round trip to England to get essential medicines because of their cancelled clinics. And we even heard one of the sufferers openly discussing suicide. So can I ask the First Minister, when she and her government are contemplating what are incredibly difficult decisions that governments are making, what consideration has been given to the longer term impacts on the physical and mental health of the nation during an extended lockdown?
First Minister.
See, these are really important questions, and if I can just give a general assurance, they're very much at the centre of our thinking about how we start to recover from this phase of dealing with COVID-19. On the urgent cancer referrals, it is a concern that we've seen that reduction in urgent cancer referrals. Brian Whittle cited the figure of 70%, which is where it was. We have seen that reduced, so it's now about 50% down, which is still too much, but it aligns with what I said earlier on, that we are starting to see these referrals go up again, but we want to accelerate that. There have been some horrendous judgments that have had to be made here, driven by the overall consideration of patient safety. So some judgments have had to be made that it is safer to postpone an operation than potentially have somebody who may have a compromised immune system coming out of their own home to get treatment where they may be exposed to the virus. As we move into this next phase, bringing those procedures back in a phased and safe way is our priority, and we hope to see that start very, very soon, although it will be phased over a number of weeks. But we will be, again, in those decisions driven by clear considerations of clinical priority, and obviously cancer is one of these clinical priorities. The Health Secretary, as part of the phasing of getting life back to as much normality as possible, will keep Parliament updated on the details of that work as it progresses.
Thank you. And question number seven, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government will follow the STUC's suggested red lines when easing lockdown restrictions to ensure the safety of workers.
First Minister.
The approach and principles to guide us out of current lockdown restrictions are set out in our framework for decision making, and decisions will very much be made in partnership with trade unions and businesses and in line with our fair work principles. We are working with the STUC and its affiliated unions, with employers, regulators and others, to create the conditions for safe workplaces, and that includes developing sector-specific guidance which will provide assurance and confidence to workers, employers, customers and businesses when the time is right to return to work. We're also working closely with the key enforcement agencies, the Health and Safety Executive, local authorities and the police, to ensure a joined-up approach to the enforcement and monitoring of workplace public health measures.
Grant.
Does the First Minister share my concerns and the concerns of a number of my constituents who are being forced back to work? They're faced with making the choice between their safety and their livelihood, and most are unaware of the statutory protections that Section 44 of the 1996 Employment Act gives them. It stipulates that all workers have a legal right to stay away from their workplace if it's unsafe. I'm therefore asking the First Minister to make a public statement setting out that statutory protection and to reiterate the duty placed on employers to ensure that workplaces are safe before asking employees to return. And will she also set out clear guidance to employers to protect workers and sanctions where they won't?
First Minister.
I agree very much with the sentiment and detail of Rhoda Grant's question. Can I say to her, I did make such a public statement yesterday when I gave the daily update yesterday. I was very clear that no employer should be forcing anybody back to work, and I made the point that she has rightly made right now, that there are statutory protections for workers, and I also encouraged them to seek help and advice from their trade union where that was necessary and appropriate. So I will take all opportunities to do that again, because I think it's important that everybody hears that message. And so I'll do it just now. I am not, as of right now, I am not encouraging anybody who is not working right now, or any business that is not open right now, to be back open and working. We will set out our phasing for that in due course. But the stay-at-home message is the overriding public health message that I want to give to people across Scotland. And I would say to employers, particularly those who perhaps work in different parts of the UK, and this is a point the UK government has helpfully made, it is the public health guidance in each area that should be followed. And so if you're employing people in Scotland, it is the public health guidance in Scotland you should be following and respecting that, and not forcing workers or seeking to force workers back to work. We will produce guidance and be very clear about that. I mentioned the sector specific guidance. We've got 14 work streams covering a number of sectors right now to produce that guidance in partnership with business and with trade unions. The final point I would make is this one, and it's a fundamental part of the approach we are taking. When we do, and hopefully it will be sooner rather than later, when we do start to encourage people to go back to work, although the guidance for those who can work at home will continue to be that for the foreseeable future, but when we are encouraging people to go back into workplaces or encouraging parents to send their children back to school, we must be satisfied that that is as safe as possible, and we must be able to assure workers and parents that it is as safe as possible. It's really important that we get these things round the right way, and we're not encouraging people to go back to work before we've given that assurance, and we'll continue to take these steps in a very careful and measured way, guided by the best evidence at every step.
Thank you. We've got a number of supplementaries. The first from Angela Constance, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Angela Constance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My constituent, Mick Gallagher, was a 34-year-old agency care worker who tragically lost his life to coronavirus. His grieving partner, mother and family are understandably asking why there is no death in service benefit payable to social care workers in Scotland, akin to either what was announced for social care workers in England or introduced by the Scottish Government for NHS workers. I know the Cabinet Secretary for Health wants to work with care sector employers in the public, private and voluntary sector and has reached out to them. So I'd be grateful if the First Minister can outline what the Scottish Government can and will do to ensure that the debt of gratitude that we owe to all carers is paid in kind, and that there is parity for social care workers in Scotland. Thank you.
First Minister.
Angela Constance raises a really important issue, and let me be very clear, it is our intention that there will be parity for social care workers as those who work in the NHS currently have. The Health Secretary has written formally to local authorities and to care home providers asking for the discussion about how we practically make that happen, and we'll be following that up, and we'll keep not just Angela Constance but the Chamber advised of that. In basic terms, we've been able to do that directly for the NHS because the Scottish Government via health boards are the employers of NHS staff. We are not the employers of social care staff directly, so it is not the same. We cannot simply take the same approach, but we absolutely intend that social care staff will not be in a disadvantageous situation should they die from this virus and their families are left in a worse position than NHS staff. This is something that the Health Secretary has taken forward as a matter of priority, and will continue to keep the Chamber updated.
Liam Kerr, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hourglass Scotland, formerly Action on Elder Abuse Scotland, tell me they are the only charity in Scotland working exclusively to support and protect older victims of abuse. Recently, they learned that their funding application to the Third Sector Resilience Fund was rejected, and their application to the Communities Fund yielded only £12,000, which is £60,000 less than required. Their suggestion is that smaller charities may not be receiving the funds they require to deliver the services Scotland needs at this time. So will the First Minister investigate both the Hourglass situation and the funding of smaller charities more generally to ensure that whatever can be done is?
First Minister.
Yes, I'm happy to look into that further. We've obviously, which is really alluded to in the question, we've made additional funding available for the charitable sector. That is still finite, so there have to be processes in place to allocate that funding, and it's important that there is a bit of independence in that, and it's not simply at the whim of ministers, and that's important whenever we allocate funding. But it is also really important that there's a fairness about that, and that smaller organisations as well as larger organisations have the ability to benefit. So without sort of straying into the particular details of the specific charity that Liam Kerr has raised, I will certainly ask the Community Secretary to have a look at that to see whether there is more we can do for smaller organisations in particular.
Colin Smith, to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has just reiterated her stay-at-home message, only travel to work if it's essential. But what message does she have for my constituents who work at Prestwick Aircraft Maintenance? They've been told by their bosses right from the very start of the COVID-19 outbreak, you must keep going to work, servicing aeroplanes that frankly aren't flying anywhere anytime soon. Rather than furloughing staff, the company are cutting their wages by 50% and sacking those who don't sign up to the cut. And one reason the company get away with making people carry out this work, which is clearly not essential, is because they know that the government guidance, the message from the First Minister, is not currently legally enforceable. So does the First Minister agree we do need regulations to tackle this type of abuse in the same way the government implemented regulations preventing some businesses like restaurants opening, to make sure that as we do move towards exit and we don't continue to have this type of abuse by employers?
First Minister.
On the particular issue of Prestwick Airport, I'm very happy to look into that and understand a bit more about the reasons why that has been seen as essential work. But let me be very clear, my message applies to all employers, unless the guidance we issued, which to the businesses that are not in the legally closed category, but equally not at the other end of the spectrum where they are doing essential work to keep the country going, there is guidance to those companies in that middle category saying, you have to judge whether what you're doing is essential. Can you allow staff to work at home? And if not, can you ensure safe social distancing? So that guidance has not changed, but I'm happy to look into the specific example. On the issue of regulations, which I think is a valid point to raise, the regulations that are currently in place have to be reviewed every 3 weeks, and the next review date is the 28th of May. And as we start to ease some of these restrictions, then that will necessitate changes to these regulations. But as we start to ease some restrictions, it may well be that other things we're asking people to do become even more important, like socially distancing while we're at work. So it may be that we look to amend those regulations for that purpose as well. So whether and to what extent within regulations we have requirements for employers will be part of that ongoing consideration. So I'll certainly give further thought to the points that the member has raised.
Richard Lyle to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Officer, does the First Minister believe yesterday's announcement from the Chancellor of the Exchequer that the Westminster Government is extending the furlough scheme provides enough reassurance for Scottish workers and their families?
First Minister.
I think yesterday's announcement was very welcome, because I think it took away that immediate potential cliff edge where companies would have no choice but to start to look at redundancy procedures. There has been an issue raised that was initially raised, I know, yesterday by Alison Thewlis about the amount of subsidy and the fact that at a later stage the government would be looking to employers to pay some of that. So instead of 80% coming from the government, perhaps only 60% would. So I think those details are details that we are still keen to understand and to make sure that is a scheme that is doing what it needs to do, which is to avert the need for companies to make workers redundant. But in general terms, of course, we welcome that scheme, and we welcome every extension of that scheme, because we must keep in place support for businesses for as long as government's advice is what is stopping businesses operating as normal.
Liam MacArthur to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the First Minister will be aware, COVID has brought air travel to a standstill. Airlines and airports across the globe face an uncertain future and are busy reviewing their own business models. So why then has the Scottish Government not asked Highlands and Islands airports to do likewise in relation to their controversial plans to centralise air traffic services across the region? But why did ministers give the go-ahead to HIAL to launch an £8.5 million procurement last week on an option that HIAL's own advisers have said is the most risky and most costly? And why are these decisions being taken at the same time as an Islands impact assessment is being carried out, rather than waiting for its conclusion?
First Minister.
Can I thank Liam MacArthur, and it's good to have him join us from afar today. I will discuss further with the Transport Secretary the points he's made. Obviously, this is something that predates the coronavirus outbreak, but like everything else, we have to be prepared to look at things in the light of the impact of this virus. There is going to be a significant implication for aviation, not just in the domestic sense, but globally as well. What Liam MacArthur is talking about has been part of Highlands Islands Airport's normal modernisation programme, and we've had exchanges in the chamber before about that. But in light of his question, I'll have further discussions with the Transport Secretary, and he would be very happy to talk more in detail with Liam MacArthur about what the impact of coronavirus might mean for these plans moving forward.
Thank you. Stuart McMillan to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's report by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation indicates that, according to the NHS figures, 22.7% of confirmed COVID-19 infections come from the 20% most deprived areas. And whilst I accept that the immediate task is to save lives and also increase testing, I can ask the First Minister to ensure that when we do transition from lockdown, that social justice is firmly at the heart of any decision-making, including working with and listening to the 20% most deprived areas.
First Minister.
I can give that assurance that social justice will be at the heart of everything we do here as we come out of this phase and as we look at what we have to do to repair the damage that has been done to the economy and to society by this virus. In terms of Inverclyde, the Health Secretary, I understand, is going to be meeting with the Chief Executive of Inverclyde Council to talk about the particular impact on Inverclyde, although I think as we go through this pandemic, we will see different areas, I think, impacted in different ways. What looks like a disproportionate impact now may or may not look like that in a few months' time. But social justice has to be at the heart of this. As I said earlier on, it has to be at the heart of how we come out of lockdown, so that we're not coming out of lockdown in a way that is just about the economy, but actually pays attention to how people live their lives and their quality of life, but also thinks about the harms that have been done by what we've had to do to tackle the virus and how we repair that, as well as get back on track with the priorities we had before this virus struck us, not least tackling poverty and child poverty in particular.
Graeme Simpson to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've seen figures in the past few days applying to North and South Lanarkshire, which show that the monthly rate of deaths from suspected overdoses is currently more than twice what it was last year. Now, that suggests there could be a link to lockdown. Is the First Minister able to say what the figure is across the country? And if she isn't, if she doesn't have those figures at her fingertips, perhaps she's able to find out.
First Minister.
I don't have that figure to hand. If we are able to give that figure nationally, I will provide it to the member and make it available to all members. Joe Fitzpatrick's convenes the task force on drug deaths and misuse that met this morning, I think. So obviously these issues are very much to the fore in those considerations as well. I mean, I would say generally, and the point rightly has been raised about overdoses, but you know, we are acutely aware of the fact that what we are doing to tackle this virus is creating harm in other ways, and that is what we have to balance as we move forward right now to reduce harm overall. And you know, the mental health impact, the wider health impacts, the stress and isolation caused by a lot of this is very much in our thinking. We published, when we reviewed the regulations last week, we published some analysis of the other harms, which is available for members to look at. So that analysis will continue to sit alongside the work we're doing to assess the suppression of the virus and where we move on from that. But if there's more information on the specific point that I can provide, I'll make sure that we provide that as soon as possible.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, 429 of 751 National Trust for Scotland jobs, including 16 at Brodick Castle in my own constituency, are at immediate risk as the charity struggles during this pandemic. Income has plummeted across its iconic attractions, which account for 54% of visits to Ayrshire and Arran following lockdown. Although NTS has acted urgently to sell non-heritage land and property while seeking support from grant-giving bodies, total losses could run to £74 million this year. What will the Scottish Government do to ensure NTS survives, along with the often beautiful and historic heritage it protects, ranging from the haunting island of St Kilda to Bannockburn and the birthplace of Robert Burns, thereby saving jobs and the National Trust's historical legacy for future generations?
First Minister.
Can I thank Kenny Gibson for raising this? We all want National Trust for Scotland not just to survive, but to thrive. It's such an important part of who we are as a country, to make sure that we showcase our national assets, not just to a domestic audience, but to a global audience as well. So we will certainly be having discussions with NTS to see what the Scottish Government can do to help them through what is a difficult period. But you know, I'm not saying anything now that people don't know. The impact of this, particularly on our tourist sector, is significant and is going to continue to be felt. So our, not just NTS, but all of those organisations, businesses that are dependent on visitors are having a really, really difficult time right now. So some of this is going to take a while for us to work through as we recover from this. But we will, whether it's NTS or any other organisation, we'll work as closely as possible and continue to provide as much support as is reasonably possible for us to do.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the First Minister assure me that in all policies on COVID-19, that she will apply basic human rights of older people, and in particular consider the UN guidance, which says that older people should be able to enjoy human rights and fundamental freedoms when residing in shelter, care or treatment facility, and for their right to make decisions about their care and quality of lives? I wonder if the First Minister would consider that going forward, when she's considering how she wants to take forward the easing of restrictions on the lockdown, that doctors' leaders have said that any restrictions should be based on individual risk instead of an arbitrary age, because applying an arbitrary age could potentially cause more lives due to the risk of depression and anxiety by being so disconnected from society. I know these decisions are difficult, First Minister, but I hope that you will consider doctors' leaders' advice when you come to make that decision.
First Minister.
This is a really, really important issue that Pauline McNeill has raised, and undoubtedly, out of a whole number of really difficult judgments, is going to be one of the most difficult going forward. Can I say, first of all, as we said very clearly in the framework for decision-making that we published a few weeks ago, human rights, equity, fairness, these principles have to be running right through every single decision we take. That's true generally, but I think it is particularly true of older people. One of the discussions we'll be having, it'll be very much clinically informed and driven over the next period as we we try to evolve out of where we are right now, is how we best protect and care for those with significant health conditions, those in the current shielded group, but also those in the older population. Because there is a real need to protect. The exchanges we've had today in care homes highlights this, but it's not just older people in care homes. Older people, you know, 9 out of 10, possibly even more than that now, on the basis of today's figures, of deaths from this virus have been in the over 65 age group. This is a virus that is particularly deadly for older people who get it, although the majority will still not suffer serious illness or die from it. And some of the judgments here are difficult. I see right now, I don't see it, I hear it on the phone and everything, the impact on my own parents, on my much more elderly mother-in-law of not seeing grandchildren right now. And there are absolutely judgments that are going to have to be made about trying to protect and preserve as much as possible the quantity of life of older people and not have them exposed to this virus on the one hand, but on the other hand, recognise their quality of life and have very much at the heart of that individual choice and autonomy of decision making. So, you know, much of what I end up saying just now is these decisions are really difficult, because they are really difficult, but the kind of principles and the kind of judgments that Pauline McNeill has spoken about have to be very much at the heart of that. I guess for many older people, particularly of the kind of age group of my mother-in-law, who's 90, and will not appreciate me talking about it in the chamber, so I'll stop that right now. You know, if you say to people like that, you know, do you want us to protect you in a way that will preserve your life for, you know, X number of years, or do you want us to allow you to see your grandkids? You know, they may come to different decisions than we would come to on their behalf. And I don't know what the right and the wrong of that is, but I know that these are some of the most difficult decisions we're going to have to make, given that we will be living with this virus for quite some time to come.
And Andy Whiteman.
The First Minister was sent a letter this morning from over 100 charities, faith groups, academics, trade unions, arguing that much more needs to be done to get emergency welfare support to struggling families. Does she agree that indeed is the case, and that this can be done with existing devolved social security powers?
First Minister.
I haven't seen the letter yet, although I have seen reports of it, and I will, of course, pay very close attention to it. I don't mean to in any way underplay the importance of the content of that letter, because I think it is exceptionally important. But I guess my view on all of this is much more needs to be done on all of this. We are dealing with the most difficult, impactful situation that any of us have faced in our lifetimes. The implications and the consequences of what we've lived through these last couple of months are profound, and real damage has been done. As we come out of this, we are going to have to repair that damage and get back to pursuing the priorities that we want. Now, there's lots of positive opportunities in that, but making sure that we take the decisions in the right way, in the right order, with the right priority, is going to be essential. We have the powers that we have that gives us certain social security powers. The child payment is an example of what we are already planning to do with that. Resources are not infinite. We have to make judgments about the resources, but I can say to Andy Whiteman that tackling poverty, tackling child poverty, making sure that we deal with the social and economic impacts on people's lives of this crisis will absolutely be at the top of our list of considerations when we're mapping and navigating our way forward.
Thank you very much. And on that note, we are going to conclude First Minister's questions. I just urge members to be careful when leaving the chamber, maintain social distance. Parliament will resume at 2:15 with a statement from the Lord Advocate. I suspend this meeting.